Life is about perspective. Two people can look at the same thing and see something completely different. When it comes to a basketball court, some people see a place for people to play games. Somebody else will take a look at that same basketball court and see 94 feet of possibilities, 94 feet of opportunities, a place where young boys and young girls can come to dream beyond their surroundings. Basketball provides the opportunity for young boys and girls to learn the life lessons of patience, teamwork, persistence, hard work, dedication, and determination. There's a group within Macomb County led by Thomas Barnes that decided to provide those 94 feet of opportunity to young boys and young girls across the county. They've rehabbed and refurbished two courts already, with plans of continuing this process all across county and into Detroit as well. Today I sat down and had a conversation with members of the group to talk about their mission, their vision, and why it's important to their communities.
All right, there we go. All right, so came over to the park with Thomas Barnes. We already were over at Mount Clemens Park and took a look at what it was doing for the community. There was probably 50 kids out there playing and just in love with the environment. There was a different level of pride. We talked to a couple of the guys that went to Mount Clemens, some that are currently at Mount Clemens, and talked about what that meant to them and what it means to the community. And now seeing this project and talking to Mary, tell me a little bit, what ignited you to say, let me do this for these courts? What made you want to bring something back to the communities the way that you have?
So for the last 20 years, I've been running a youth mentoring program, and as we were out in the communities, we were always looking for a place to pull over and play basketball, man. We could never find them. Then as we did more research, we found out that there had been a systematic tearing down of basketball courts across Macomb County, because at every basketball court, there were neighbors' complaints about, nefarious individuals hanging out at the basketball courts. And those incidents preempted those municipalities to start taking down the courts. So we decided that with basketball being as big as it is, and it's something culturally that's ours, right? Something that belongs to us. The NBA has embraced us in this hour of social justice reform. So I felt like it was necessary for us to rehab the surviving courts that were here, to make them a source and a sense of pride, to attach the kids from our community back to their school districts again.
You said something that stood out to me. You said in this hour of social justice reform, what can we do within the community to stretch that hour to a day, into a week, into a year? What are some things that we can do to make it not just a moment, but something that's powerful moving forward?
I mean, I think it's ownership, right? So like our communities, we have felt so outcasted in our own neighborhoods for so long, but now is the time for us to take ownership in that, right? I've heard a lot of, black people growing up that would say, I can't wait till I get old or get rich so I can move out of here. But it's like, why would I want to leave something that's innately mine, right? Tupac said, when I get rich, I can't move out because I don't feel comfortable being nowhere else, right? So even if I get rich and I move to the Hollywood Hills, I'm never going to feel comfortable because I'm still black. I can't never take the veil of being black off of me. I'm still going to be black in the white neighborhood. So I'm going to go look for those areas. I'm going to go look for that Compton or that Detroit where I feel like I'm at home because I'm with us. So why can't I build that here? Why can't I have my Wakanda right here?
And that's what you're doing with the courts, is building that sense of pride. And in your wildest imagination, did you think it would look like this when it was done?
Man, I'm telling you, Mary is an absolute genius. Like, in my head, I've seen these things, right? And you don't believe that they can be done until you see the real manifestation of it, right? Until you're sweating out here in 80 degree, 90 degree weather under a hot Michigan sun, baking, putting paint on these courts for hours. But, I got to give credit, Project Backboard inspired us. We seen what Project Backboard was doing across the country, and we decided to take that sense of ownership on ourselves to say, if you can do it there, why can't we do it here?
Absolutely. I mean, without a doubt, you've inspired me for the last 8 years, and we, every time we have those conversations and we talk about, that sense of pride in community, that sense of growth and trying to give back and be what we needed when we were their age, and seeing, not only the talk, but the walk. We always talk about the audio matching the visual. And,
absolutely.
I see I see year after year, you take it to another level. And seeing this, it makes me wonder, what's that next level? What's next for these communities?
Well, I mean, the thing is combined impact, right? So I, as an individual, can only do so much. Now it's time to bring buy-in from all community stakeholders to say, look, this is what's possible. Let you take it to that next level so that we can continue moving through the county and moving through the state, bringing these places back to life, giving the community a sense of pride, giving the school district a sense of pride. You know, we had a little girl that wrote an essay for our Ministerial Alliance for our Martin Luther King essay contest last year, and she said, school of choice is the new separate but equal. So, like, if you go to a school that is actively the victim of white flight, then you're stuck, right? So now you live in the projects, your school is failing you, your community is failing you, you live in fear for your life. But who's gonna reach back in and start rebuilding in those areas? You know, we complain about gentrification, but we're not willing to step in and stop gentrification by rebuilding it ourselves, right? So why not, right?
No, I agree 100%. I think that we need more people like you within the community that not only see the vision but are willing to sacrifice their own interests or their own money, time, etc. to build up that community. So I'm hoping
there's people like us though, right? Because we is greater than me.
Absolutely.
Right? So there's no way that I can continue to do things as one person, because if I die, then the dream dies with me.
Absolutely.
But if I'm able to inspire the next generation of people, the next generation of kids, that'll continue going through generations because of that level of inspiration that they found from something that we were able to impact. So it's a combined effort. It can't be one-on-one. It's got to be all of us. We all have to have these complicated and complex conversations that are going to lead us to rebuilding our communities.
That's, man, I'm excited. I'm excited for this. I'm excited for the community. I'm excited for Macomb County and all the things I know you're going to continue to do. I appreciate you. I appreciate the work that you've done and the impact, the influence that you've had, not only on my life, but on hundreds of lives and thousands of lives without the community, lives you don't even know. I mean, literally having conversations today, people, you know, I'm so happy Tommy did this for us. I'm so happy he saw the vision for this. And I think that it's important that we, you know, a lot of times we say, okay, who am I? I'm just one person. I can't, what can I do? But not realizing that to that one person to somebody is everybody, is everything.
Right.
And, you know, being able to have that vision of change. And I appreciate that. And I know this community appreciates you. And now we got more work to do.
So Michael Jordan was only one person though, right?
Yeah.
Right? Martin Luther King was only one person. So to disavow yourself by saying, I'm only one person, I'm so small, what can I impact? It doesn't matter your background, it doesn't matter where you came from, doesn't matter your education, doesn't matter your financial standing, doesn't matter if you spent the last 20 years in prison, you can have impact by just getting out there and doing those things.
I'm just gonna ask some questions about the court. Well, both courts, because we just visited Mount Clemens Court. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah, I saw the Mount Clemens Court after it came together, and it's absolutely phenomenal. And now seeing this, I mean, this is mind blowing. So, talk to me about taking the concept that Tommy brought you about repurposing these courts and making them, you know, lively again for the kids, and then you seeing that concept and bringing it to life. Talk to me a little bit about that.
Well, like you know, like Tommy and I, we started out. He introduced me to doing the court in Mount Clemens last year. Mm-hmm. And we had such great response with that. And everybody was a little bit leery on, you know, donating money for it and whatnot. So he paid me out of his pocket for that. But with him being a mentor, he really wanted to give the kids something special, something to be proud of. And to this day, it's still being very well taken care of. I mean, they love it. Everybody's like, wow, you know. Yeah. And so that's how we got the idea for this, to just go into the different neighborhoods and, again, give the kids something to be very proud of and whatnot. And he kind of gets a visual in his mind, and then I come up with different designs. He's like, yep, that's it. Then, of course, we have to submit them in and, you know, get a digital artist to do it up, and, you know, that's not my forte. And then it's voted on and whatnot, and then we bring in the logos, everything that the, you know, the townships want and whatnot.
Seeing it come together and seeing the response that the kids have had, what does that mean to you? Like, what does that do for you, for your spirit?
Tommy kept saying, because this is his volunteer stuff. And I kept saying it, and he kept telling me, well, you don't get it. Like, I don't get it. And I got one day, all the kids coming out all the time, and they're just like, wow, Miss Mary, thank you. This is so awesome. And I mean, the most respectful kids, everybody. I would see the same people at least twice a week where they come out just to check the progress and stop and, you know, chit-chat and whatnot. And one day I got this phenomenal email message. It was probably one of the top 10 warmest things that I've ever received in my entire life. And he said, you know, it was a younger gentleman, you know, older teenager, I would probably guess. And he was just so thankful. He said that, you know, not all angels wear wings. And he said, I can't believe that there are people out there that care this much. And I called Tommy. I said, okay, now I get it. Now I get it. So that was probably the most important part. But I mean, just everyone coming out and being so excited and wanting to be so involved in it was.
And when you look at it and you think about now that this project's done and now seeing what it's done for the community, you know, what are some of your hopes and goals for kind of it being a catalyst for change and for, you know, growth within that youth and that next generation?
Oh, I mean, hopefully this catches on. I mean, honestly, look at all the kids out here. They're so excited about it. We've already had a couple different, I don't know if they were parks or schools that Tommy had said had gotten in touch and said, you know, we really would like to do this with our place. So hopefully I have more opportunities to do that.
I hope so too, because you did a phenomenal job.
Thank you.
I love to see this artwork. I love to see, you know, what you're doing for the communities. I think that, you know, what that email said, not all angels wear wings, it's spot on. You know, you're doing the work.
That was just like probably one of the warmest messages I'd ever gotten. So that was great.
This is amazing. I'm not from the community, but it brings, just looking at it, warms my heart, knowing that the kids have something to call their own, a place to come to and be proud of and be excited about. You know, I think that's, you know, work that's invaluable. So I appreciate you. Thank you for all that you do.
Thank you.
My name is Rashida Hammond. I'm a city commissioner here in the city of Mount Clemens. I'm also a Head Start teacher here in Mount Clemens at the Family Resource Center.
Awesome. Awesome. So Rashida, how long have you been a part of the community here?
Well, I've been part of the community as a little girl, very young. My grandparents both have homes here in Mount Clemens, of the River Acres community.
Yep.
So my parents would always bring me back here to Mount Clemens to play at my grandparents' house in the summertime and to visit my grandparents.
Awesome.
Both my parents are from Mount Clemens. They went to the high school, so yes.
What made you want to be a city commissioner?
For the betterment of the community. Have some input in the community. Representation for the community, yes.
So what are some of the goals that you have, let's just say 5 years, you know, what are some of the things that you'd like to see within the community, like to see happen here?
The Parks and Recreation Program is something that I'm big on, and that's one of the things I ran on, is to get an active Parks and Recreation Program here in the city.
So you talk about Parks and Recs, and just so happens we're here at the court, and they've done a fantastic remodel of it, cleanup of it. Now you're seeing life coming back to it, the kids coming out and playing. What does this court mean to the community, or what does it mean to you, your perspective of it?
The court has history here in the community, and it's to me, it's a foundation for the youth and the young adults to come together and bond here playing basketball. When the community center was open, going to the community center and participating in the different events there.
Absolutely. You talk about Parks and Recs. What are some things that you'd like to see come back to the community, or what are some things that you think the community needs from that standpoint?
Organized sports is what I would like to see coming back to the community.
Awesome.
Something that the youth can participate in.
Awesome.
My name is Darian Downing. I'm a student at Saginaw Valley State University. It's my third year. I'm a pre-med student, but my major is corporate finance. So,
Darian, extremely excited to talk about the court here. You know, I've seen this thing go from what it was back in the day to ideas of what it could be to now what it is. And, you know, I think that it's something that's very vital for not only for the community, but for the youth within the community to have hope, have somewhere that they can call their own, have some pride in. So growing up in the community, growing up in the area, obviously this wasn't around when you were here, but what does it mean to you now? What does the rededicated court mean to you now? What do you think that it means to the younger generation?
I feel like since no gym's open in this quarantine right now, I feel like the court is like the rose out of concrete. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's the heart of our little community and everything. because the gym's not open. Even when the gyms are open, it's, you know, a lot of kids can't go to the gyms for free, and a lot of kids don't got money to get in the gym. And this place always open and it's always free. So I don't remember the last time I seen the court this live. Probably when I was like in, I don't know, like seventh grade or something. We was all up here, but it's all different age groups up here now. Really, it was just us as kids, but it's, you got the OGs coming from around the corner, and you got little kids coming from down the street, people my age, people coming from college, people coming from 15 mile coming to hoop at our court.
So one of the things, you know, you and I had a conversation a couple weeks ago, and we talked about being that lead generation for these young kids coming up, being able to give them, you know, hope. And you know, for example, a young man like you coming from this community and being a pre-med student, being a student that, you know, you're studying corporate finance, that's not something that you see. First of all, there's not a whole lot of young black men in college, but to say that, hey, I'm studying corporate finance, I'm pre-med, I want to be a doctor. Talk to me a little bit about being a part of that change that you want to see for the community in years to come.
I just feel like if the kids always see negative role models, then they're going to think the negative role model is positive. But if they see the positive one, then, you know, we're going to have a positive outcome, because they're going to make our, you know, our whole community and our whole generation and take care of me when I get old. So
for sure. For sure. For sure. I'll tell you, man, it's been a pleasure watching you grow up. Like I said, we were just talking about it. I remember us being on this court when you were, you know, you were little. You were that generation that we're talking about being the hope for. So I'm proud of you, man. Continue to be a beacon of hope and light for the young men and young women within the community. And anything you need, you know you got me.
Yes, sir.
All right. All right, you can go hoop now.
All right. Hey, what up? Twan D. I'm a Mount Clemens alumni. You know what I'm saying? Born and raised in Mount Clemens. Graduated 2004. I'm a musician, a barber out here in Mount Clemens. You know.
You're from Mount Clemens. You graduated from Mount Clemens. This court's a part of your life. Tell me what this court means to you before the rebirth of the remodel of it.
I was up here every day. Coming up, we used to shovel the snow off the court. Like when I was coming up, it was that only this side. And then like I think what, middle school, high school, they built this side. But yeah, like we used to come out here in the rain. Me and my boy used to play 1-on-1 full court, you know, but loved it. You know, it was real big when I was coming up. This is where it started for me. Like I loved basketball growing up. You know what I'm saying? Like basketball was my first, you know, over everything. So like with it being this, like painted new, like I love it. I love it. And you know, the tribute to Ved, you know, that's a good thing. Good look. I knew Ved. He actually passed at our homecoming. October 6th, my sister's birthday. So yeah, but yeah, I love it, love it.
Seeing new life and seeing the kids in the community coming out and playing, seeing them organizing it, and this being a place for them, like a safe haven within everything else that's going on. What do you think the value of them having a place they can call their own is? What does that sense of pride and ownership mean to you?
A lot, man, because this could be a place where it can keep them out of trouble. You know what I'm saying? They don't have to be running the streets. They can come up here, get a peace of mind, shoot around, exercise, meet new people. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, it's a lot. It means a lot, man.
With everything that's going on, and you know, I talked to Tom, and he mentioned you as a community activist, as somebody that brings people together, as somebody within this community that is a voice of reason, is a voice of power. What are some things that you're looking to see happen within this community, happen within this city moving forward?
Well, we need to come together more. You know what I'm saying? It's a lot of separation in Mount Clemens, and everybody against each other. I feel like if the community come together as one, we can grow. You know, grow a whole lot, man. And and then like as far as like the kids, man, the kids need mentors like Tommy. Tommy is real good for what's going on right now with the younger generation, and he doing a great job with it.
Awesome. Any parting words, anything you want to leave for the youth?
Stay focused. Work hard. If you want something, you go get it. Don't let nobody discourage you. You know, just work hard and go get it. Listen. Listening is a hard part for a lot of people nowadays, man. They don't want to listen. They think they know it. So just listen, man. Listen to people that's trying to teach you something and soak it in. But yeah, stay focused. don't get discouraged in your dreams and just keep pushing forward, moving forward.
My name is Kyrie Hay, and I'm a senior class of 2021.
So over the summer, we caught up. We trained a little bit out here when COVID and guys couldn't get inside of gyms. How important was it to have somewhere to come and be able to get on the court and continue to work on your game?
It was very important because, like you said, there was nowhere else to train. So the fact like that you even considered coming out to help the kids in the first place was like, it meant a lot. And then it also helped a lot because it showed that people in Mount Clemens care. And that we didn't just clean the court and do everything for no reason. Like, people still show that this is their environment and that they want to still do something here.
What does it mean to you when you come up and you see a group of kids playing and a bunch of guys all around? What does it mean to you knowing that there's that sort of pride in the community and that sort of, you know, kind of camaraderie and relationships out there?
It makes me happy because when I first moved here, nobody came to the court. So like, it means like, they seen that it was clean. So like, they felt like they could come back, like it was a home again.
My name is Kiana Dorsey. I'm the president of UMTAP Greatness Organization. And I've lived in this area on and off all my life. And I just have a passion for making a change here.
So you've lived in this area all your life. Talk to me a little bit about the transformation for the court and seeing it go from where it was to where it's at now and the impact that it's had on the community.
Well, it was no paint here, circles all around because people were coming and doing donuts. So we had to paint the whole thing. And like now it's something beautiful, something people that can be proud of. And like someone said, they haven't been up here in a long time, but they came here because of this basketball court. And I think it makes people more proud to say that this is their home when there's something nice to look at.
Do you believe that the court's going to have that domino effect for, you know, people saying, okay, I need to fix up this or I need to do that or what can we do next?
Yes, it definitely gives people hope for our community. It makes them say, oh, this looks nice, let's do other things to make it look nice. Because if you come here and you've been here all your life, you don't get excited about it. And a lot of people want to leave. A lot of people have left. So it's like they can come here and say, this looks good. There's making a change. This is a start, basically.
Talk to me a little bit about your foundation and what it does within the community.
Well, the Untapped Greatness Foundation, I started it by just going around finding people that I know have done things in the community before and they've been here all their lives. And I just, you know, got them together, asked them, do they want to help me start a nonprofit organization? And we've been going for about 5 months and we've done a few different events in the community. And we're all about empowering our community by engaging them and, you know, having social events, recreational events, giving classes, because a lot of the kids around here, they don't have anything to do, and that's why I started looking for other people to make a change to do that, because a lot of people, they don't have anything to do. It's like, who are they? We are the they that don't have anything to do for our children, so we have to change that if we want to see a change.
Absolutely. And, you know, when you look at the court as being that beacon of hope, what are some of the things that you're looking for on the heels of this? What are some of those next steps for this community?
To start educational program and recreational program, and that we can do weekly, build it up to daily. And you know, kids come up to this park and there's really not much to do, but if we start seeing people have an investment in this community because they see this basketball court, there's eyes on this basketball court in this park in this community that have never had eyes on it before, just because this is the start of that.
Well, I think that, you know, without a doubt, this provides a level of, like you said, a sense of pride, a sense of hope, a sense of possibility of what could be, what can be, and what should be. So I'm definitely looking to see growth within the community. I think that, you know, with people like yourself and Tommy and Mary involved and all having that heart for, you know, the next level and heart for the next generation, without a doubt, I see progress happening. I mean, progress has already happened between the two courts that have been done within the last 2 years. And I know that, you know, that's only the beginning and there's more to come. So I appreciate all that you do for the community, and I'm looking forward to seeing the growth.
Right, my name is Eric Thompson Jr. I'm actually an author, and I work at Clendale High School. I'm a high school basketball coach at Clendale.
Okay, yeah. Nice. So talk to me a little bit about, you know, the community, and obviously, so you being entrenched in the community, entrenched in the high school, mm-hmm. you know, what you see this doing for the community?
I think it's big, just because, like, a basketball court, people look at it as just basketball, but it brings people together, like, something to take pride in, too. Like, that's what I like about it being painted, because I actually lived out here. I went to Clendale, too, so So seeing it how it looked now versus when we play is totally different, man.
Being a Clintdale guy, being an alum of Clintdale, a coach and a teacher at Clintdale, talk to me a little bit about, you know, the hope that you feel is needed for that community moving forward.
I would say, like, just having a sense of pride and taking pride in yourself and your community. I feel like when you do stuff like this, it makes them think somebody cares, and then that's gonna make them take care of it.
What are the next steps? When we talk future, when we talk the future of the community here, when we talk the future, what are some things that you'd like to see done? What are some of the things that you're looking for and looking forward to?
Just more outreach, like door-to-door, like face-to-face stuff, more so than like people just donating and giving, just touching the people, basically. I feel like that's more important.
For sure. Hey, man, I appreciate you. I know that this this is just the beginning of the change. I know that it's going to take people like you from the community that have the experience of the community. You've lived in the community. You've been educated in the community, now you work in the community. So those wraparound resources and being able to bring that to that next generation, it's big having all of you guys working together to make this happen. So I appreciate you and I thank you for all that you do.
Appreciate it, man.
All right, man.